Thank you, Professor Tandon, for the invite and the organizing committee for giving me the chance to speak to you. At the onset, I would like to tell you that this grant writing talk generally is for 45 minutes. We do it regularly for 45 minutes, followed by a grant clinic. But here, I'm tailored made it for 10 minutes only. So you might find me sometimes running around certain slides. But don't worry, this is just to give you a flavor, and we can have interaction later on here as well as or offline. I will leave my email or contact details to you. So if you have any further questions, we can take it offline. I come from an organization called the Wellcome Trust, which is a global charity based out of London. And we call ourselves the second largest charity of the world after the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And what our main mandate is to fund healthcare research leading to for improvement of human and animal health. That is the broad mandate, and we have different pots of money to fund various, from basic research to clinical validation to market validation. So there are various pots of money, from history of medicine to we have various pots, and I will direct you to visit our website www.wellcome.ac.uk to have the detail. I'll not be talking about individual initiatives. The trust was formed by this gentleman called Henry Wellcome. After his death, he left a corpus which was, you know, put into a charity to fund healthcare research. And right now, the corpus of the Wellcome Trust is around £18 billion. And from that, we get a revenue of around £600 to £700 million a year, which is used to fund basic translational and clinical research for improvement of human and animal health. We have the vision to, we have programs of individual career development programs, fellowships for individual career in basic as well as clinical research. We support brightest young mid-career and senior fellows. And we fund from basic research, public engagement, humanities, community medicine. So you name a pot which is there within our trust. This is what we do actually. And our main focus is to accelerate application of basic research to clinics. That is the gap we fund, and we call ourselves as a gap funder or a risk funder. We take that risk so that the program becomes commercially de-risked so that it can be taken up ahead. This is a key slide, and it generally takes 5-7 minutes to explain, but I will rush through this just to give you a flavor. When you start thinking of any grant application, what you should concentrate on. If you take your research programs anywhere, you will find that it will be in either of these three places. Either it will be a discovery research, which we call it a blue skies research or a basic research. It will be either developmental research, or you can say translational research, or this is the gap research, which translates your basic into something which it can be scaled up, or it can be a delivery program, like you have the full translational basic in place package. Now you want to do a clinical trial. So it will be a delivery so that, you know, you have a full package in place. So you consider your research, it has to fall in any one of these slides. Well, just a disclaimer, this is what I'm going to speak in the next 7 to 8 minutes, is just what our experience as a funder and reviewing a lot of funding applications, our experience, what we look forward as a funder in a typical good grant application. So if you are a basic researcher, what we tell you is, look into the problem in totality. Problem statement which you are making, make it in totality. What is the global burden? What is the country-specific burden you have? What are the landscape of that research you are working on? Is it a very competitive research? If it is a very competitive research, you have to be really at the high end of the program to get successful in that research. This is not just giving you a negative impact of your program, but you need to be competitive to attract funding. Just now, our chairman mentioned that funding is not a problem anymore, but you have to have a really fine and excellent idea to take it ahead. So these are the questions we always tell our applicants to challenge themselves so that you can have a really great grant proposal. So understand the problem. What are the market drivers for that problem? Is it a risky program? Where is all the funding agencies excited to fund such type of programs? So do you have an infrastructure to do such programs? So some similar types of questions, there may be n number of more questions. But what you should do is challenge yourself with these questions to write a good grant proposal. Similarly, if you are in a translational space, again, what are the IP strategies? Because IP plays a major role. What are the regulatory strategies in this program? Because if regulatory questions are not answered, you can't take your program ahead. So Again, and if it is a clinical program, what are, is there any company interest? Are CROs capable to deliver it? So there might be a number of more questions. I have just summarized some of them which are really crucial. You need to challenge yourself and answer those questions before writing an application or thinking of writing an application. This is the anatomy of typical guideline. One of my friends from NIH only shared this slide with me. This is a typical anatomy of a typical grant writing grant process. If you are a researcher, if you are a researcher, so you should look for an announcement of a funding scheme. Then, but before the funding scheme is announced, you should try to bring a collaborative network around you. You should talk to the funding agencies, program peoples. These all funding agencies have dedicated persons like me who really talk to the applicants, to talk to the researchers, who what sort of a program you are, whether you are fitting into the right scheme of things or not. So such type of questions you need to challenge yourself with. Such type of questions, try to talk to the funding agencies. Their website is called interactive. Our website and similarly a lot of other funding agencies' websites are quite interactive. You need to talk to those funding guys. And with, I have this idea. Do you have some interest? They will say, yes, we have some interest, but you should go to a different pot of money for that. Or within that scheme, you have this thing to do for it. So try to, you know, challenge the funding agencies also so that it will help you to do a due diligence onto your program as well. And you should not wait for the funding calls to be announced. You know that this is the funding agency you are going to target. Try to talk to them well in advance. So the, because generally the funding schemes are, have a you know period of around 40 days or so. When we announce a call, 40 days is the deadline for that call. So it will be very busy if you, once the call is announced, you get in touch with the funding agency. The grant advisors will be busy. They might not be able to give you the advice and things. So it is always better to start talking to the agency well in advance. So that once the scheme is announced, you are very absolutely ready to put in your application process. Grant application process, every funding agency have a typical application form and things like that you need to follow. Briefly, I'll tell you how we do, and this is basically the same for all other funding agencies as well. Then there is a referral and a review process for the funding agencies, which is typical for various funding agencies. Then you have to defend yourself in front of a funding committee. What we do is this referral and review, and these days it is followed by all funding agencies. They give you an anonymized negative feedback to you. No funding agencies will give you a positive feedback, but a negative feedback is given to you so that you can improve your program. Don't take it negatively, but we give you because so that you can challenge yourself and answer those questions when you are asked to rebut your defend your application. So take that positively and take it ahead. Then you face the funding committee, then either there is a revision or acceptance or rejection will happen and the program starts. So this is basically a broad cycle of how a funding operation or grant process works. Now there are various funding pathways. You know, there might be creative funding pathways. For example, basic research. No private company will fund or a venture capital will fund a basic research. You need to go to either the philanthropic trust like Wellcome Trust or Gates Foundation or government agencies in India, DBT, DST, ICMR will fund basic research because it's a risky program and we are allowed to take such risk to fund basic research programs. But if you are in a translational space, you can either target a venture fund or a company or you can come to Gates or us. And now government has also started funding translational research. So there are other funding. But downside, there are different funding options. I'll not talk about that because this audience, I believe, is not in that space. But there are two funding options. Either you go for a state funding or you go for a philanthropic funding, which are right now coming up in big ways and big organizations are coming up to fund basic as well as translational research. Component of successful grant application, you have to have a strong idea. Now, strong idea means you must have a concept, but it should be supported by a strong science. Strong science doesn't mean you have to do yourself, but literature shows that this can be done. Or you can, you know, what you say, you can plan a program which can support that you can be done. Sometimes you can't directly say that it can be done on the basis of literature, but you can at least give a support that, okay, this has been done and this may be able to be done. And for that, we are there to take risk to support your program that it can be done. And the strong application. Sometimes what happens, and we see it regularly, that you might have a good program, but your expression in the application is very weak. So you need to, what you think should come out in the paper. And this is what always we tell you is, when you write an application, it is not that you only review that application within your team. Ask one of your friend or a colleague to review it. If you know somebody who is good at English, just give it to him and ask him to just brush through the application. So this will really come out in a, you know, lot of people are really, and this is, believe me, I have experienced this. When we discuss with an applicant, excellent program. But when we read the application, it doesn't come out in that. And the reviewers who are sitting some 1,000 miles away from you will read only your application. They don't know your face. So I always tell my applicant, is winning a grant is telling how compelling and good story you tell. You have to be an excellent storyteller. And we have n number of examples to tell you how excellent story helped to build that application stronger. Principles of success, and this is what our experience says, so I am not, this is not any patthar ki lakir, this is what it is. But understand the peer review process in an organization. You know, and it is all there in our websites, and everybody puts it in there, but how we peer review it. So, what we do is, we do a 360-degree review of your program. It is not only the strong sign and the strong clinical background which you have, or the clinical program which you develop, but what is the exit strategy from your program? What is the IP strategy? What is the regulatory strategy? So you should think the program in full context. And peer reviews will be clinicians, will be basic scientists, will be a regulator, or will be an IP strategist, or something like that. So, you know, we have a 6 panel of 7 reviewers for an application, so we review from all angles. So you need to think that in a holistic way. Secure collaborators. That is very essential into a science. You might be a good clinician or a good basic scientist, but you might not be a good regulatory expert. What we tell you is, build that into your funding agreement, hire a good regulatory consultant into your program. Pay him good money so that he can advise you, build a good team. You should be the leader because you know the program well, but you hire expertise who can help you to deliver that program. And you build a team around you for a good clinician, good biologist, good regulator, good hospitals with you. And, you know, charge them, build into their program and present that to a funding agency. So what funding agencies see is that you have a thinking in the program, a thought-through program into your scheme of things. So you might be a good clinician or a good scientist, but you might not be, you know, have that strong idea on the downside of your program. So try to build all the aspects into the program, and it is not necessarily that you should have all the expertise. Get good people into the program, pay them as a consultant or as a contractor, and make a good team. This is what generally a basic grant proposal consists of. I will not go into detail. There is a one column on budget which I will stress here. Never under budget your program and never over budget it. That is key. You know, a lot of time we think that let us under budget it, ask X amount of money which is much less, and the funding agencies will give us, and never do that. Every funding agency has a strong grant cost challenge team these days. If you under budget it, you know, I have again number of experience where I say, oh, this can't be done in this cost, how they are going to do it? Then the funding agency feels that either the person has not thought through the program, or he doesn't know what is the cost of it. Ma'am, stop me if I exceed my time. So never under budgeted and never over budgeted. Ma'am is smiling. It happens sometimes here. I know that people think, or if you put some X amount of higher money, they said, no, itna mat do, kam karke de do. It happens. But now the thinking of the funding agencies are changing. At least we, and similarly, I know one of two other funding agencies who are really conscious of the fact that, you know, you need to have a right amount of money to run through your program. Build in smart milestones. Simple, measurable, appropriate, realistic, and time-bound. You need, if you do that, the funding agencies feel that he is the right person. For example, a lot of people write in their first milestone, hiring of a premises, review of a literature, hiring of employment. These are not milestones. If you're trying to, say, express certain protein in certain system, then say that after 1 year, X amount of protein expressed in a, such a system. Or you're doing a, say, a clinical validation program, so I'll recruit X number of patients, and this is what the target therapy I will give, and this is what I will look for. Don't worry about the an outcome of the program. It is a science-driven program. So it might be positive, it might be negative. We are there to help you out to, you know, exchange the, increase the timeline, or, you know, divert the program. It is a science. You can't guarantee what the results will come out. So but you have to have a realistic milestone so that you are measured. Don't put any, so that what, we, when we read such milestones, we see he has not thought through the program. He's trying to just, you know, bypass kar raha hai. Matlab, he just doesn't want to tell something and he's moving around. But try to be realistic in developing your milestone. Take my words, funding agency really will put you one step ahead. Because we need to write due diligences for program, and we said, oh, this is a very good milestone. They know what they are doing program, what science they are doing, what clinical outcomes they want, and they have explicitly mentioned in their milestones. Always use Gantt charts to do that. That really helps the funding agencies as well as all of us to monitor your projects and, you know, track your outcomes. Try to be clear about objectives and activities. Objective is what you want to do, and activities is how you want to do. This, we have seen a lot of times people mix these, and really it creates problem, and it confuses the reviewers, it confuses the funding agencies, and ultimately the result is not good. Align your application with these four bullets, significance of your program. Try to tell what is the unmet need. Highlight it. This is the unmet medical need and I am going to target it. Tell about yourself to the funding agency. I have this expertise to do. I have I have a team of this many people to run it. Highlight your innovative approach, how you are trying to approach, and the environment around you. For example, you are working in a hospital which is renowned. Tell the funding agency, I come from a hospital which is established in my field, and tell the story complete. No, it really helps to build the case, and it moves your grade above in our scale of evaluating you. This is, this is not my slide. I have taken from one of my colleagues. Is a good grant versus what is a bad grant. If you say significance, too much significance, it becomes kadwa. Just don't give too much significance. Just rationalize your significance to certain level. But certain things you have to give in details. For example, your work plan. Work plan tells us that you have really thought through your application. So put your concept and enforce on work plan. And try to build a good team around yourself. You might be expert on one, but try to build a good team around yourself. No matter you hire people, you contract people, and bill it to the funding agency, I'm sure you will write a very good application.